Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. And I'm so glad you all decided to come here this morning. I'm so glad some of you all woke up this morning. The rest of y'all who didn't wake up, went to glory, I see you when I get there. Some of y'all just, y'all so serious, y'all, all the time. All the time, y'all just too serious. Let's go before our Father. Father God, we come to you right now in the name of Jesus. Father God, we thank you and we love you and we appreciate you. Father God, we know that you are preparing things for us behind the scenes. And as we trust and believe in you and walk by faith, we believe we'll walk smack dab into those things, Father God. We love you and we appreciate you for those things that you have already prepared for us before the foundation of the world. And we love you, Father God. You're a good God and a good daddy. We thank you, Father. We know that there is no other God but you. Jesus, you are Lord. Now, Father God, I believe that as we go into a new adventure into your word, Holy Spirit, you are going to enlighten our understanding. Pull back the veil so that we can walk into those things that you have prepared for us. And as we confess and believe your word, Father God, we'll see your grace manifested in our everyday lives. We love you and we appreciate you, Father God. Today, Father God, I submit myself to your spirit, soul, and body. Use my mind, use my heart, use my mouthpiece to minister your word to your people this day. And we covenant with you right now, Father God, to give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory for every victory that will come out of today's session. We thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn your Bibles to the book of 2 Samuel. Before we get into spirit, soul, and body, I want to kind of bring something to your attention. Bible to 2 Samuel. Come on, what are you doing? What are you doing? There you go. Do it what you're supposed to do. 2 Samuel, chapter 2. And I want you to turn your Bibles to the book of Matthew. Where is it? Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13. In today's time, y'all know as well as I do, you got so many different things grabbing for your attention. I'm going to just use TV as the example. Now, there's many, many other things that are examples too. Many, many other things that are examples. But I'm going to use TV in this aspect. Y'all know it's some really, really good television shows on TV. It really is. It's good. On all the different kind of networks, whatever network that you like the most. I don't name any of them. I don't want to be saying anybody out. You don't need no lawsuits coming this way. But there's many, many other kind of networks. A whole lot of TV shows. And they're in it to make money. Those are actors. Those are producers. Those are writers that are, you know, trying to give you a product to watch and to, you know, so when you watching those television programs, you go out and buy the movies or go buy the series on them, whatever, however it plays all out. Well, with that being said, like I said, those things are always out there trying to grab your attention, it is making a case for you to give your attention to it. I'm going to say it again. It is making a case for you to give your attention to it. I can kind of see why now that I've gotten older, when you talk to some old heads, well, they didn't have TV years and years ago. If they did have movies, they was called flicks. You actually left the house and you had to go pay $2 or 50 cents to go watch a flick. at the movies and on a big screen with a projector, you know, you wind a projector like this. And way, way, way back when. But even prior before then, in certain parts of the world, they had, you know, there were plays where people were still acting, and but you still had to get up. And the only people who had access to plays on a wide scale was rich folk and kings and, you know, even the politicians there. And they actually went. They still actually had to leave their house and go. With the advention of radio, you know, shortwave radio, you could watch, listen to a program, but it was all just words. And they'll come on for 15-minute increments. Some of y'all might be old enough to remember that, some of y'all may not. But even then, those things were buying for your attention. So you would ask yourself, what did y'all do before TV? What did you do before Facebook? What did you do before Instagram? What did you do? We just live. When I was younger, we ran, we jumped, we played. I played all kinds of sports. Football, basketball, baseball. We were outdoors kids. Children, I'm sorry, people. We just got to say kids. We were outdoors people. And, you know, other people, they actually went camping. They went places. My wife has told me plenty of times when they would go camping all the time. We didn't do that, you know. You know, black folk didn't go camping. We just would go camping. Really? Are you kidding me? We'd go camping. You know, camping. We'd go outside and run, but camping? Tents and stuff. I ain't do all that kind. I ain't do no camping until I got to the Marine Corps. Well, anyway, that's just nothing. Something else grabbing for your attention. At some point in time, you have to slow it down, and you have to make a decision to give your attention to God. Give myself a hand clap on that one. Because that came straight from the throne. That's in any area of life. Any area of life. And so I'm going to want y'all to see something. Matthew chapter 23.
What?
Matthew 13. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Matthew 13. Y'all know what I was trying to say.
Okay.
Matthew 13. Matthew 13. Look at verse 44. Matthew 13, verse 44. Look what it says. It says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field, the which when a man hath found, he hideth it. And for joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he hath, and buyeth that field. Again, everybody say again.
Again.
Again. It says, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls, who when he hath found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. So here Jesus is, if your Bible is written in red, this is Jesus talking right here. And Jesus is giving these parables, or he's giving these examples of what the kingdom of heaven, or what the kingdom of heaven is all about. Look what he said in verse 47. Again, everybody say again.
Again.
The kingdom of heaven is like unto a net that was cast into the sea and gathered of every kind of fish that's out there, or any kind of thing that's out there. Which when it was full, they drew to shore and sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but cast the bad away. So shall it be at the end of the world. The angels shall come forth. Okay, no, I'm going to all that. He was giving examples about the end of the world, but. We're not going to talk about that. We'll just stay with the focus right here, just on the kingdom. Jesus gave three examples of the kingdom. Three examples. What was the first example? The first example was what? A man who found a treasure. And when he saw it, when he found it, tucked it away so nobody else will grab hold to it. And then what did he do? What did he do? He went and buyeth that field. He went and bought it up before somebody else can get it. Second one was he talking to connected to verse 45, but he's connected to goodly pearls. Something of value. A pearl is very, very valuable. Very, very valuable. Alright? What did he do? He sold all that he had just to buy that one pearl. Now the world will say you should not put all your eggs into one basket. But God's saying, yeah, do that. Now what we're gonna find out what this kingdom is. What it says in verse 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is what? A net. He's connecting the kingdom to like a net. When you go out and you cast it into the sea, like big fish, if you know anything about fishing, you have these big old nets. You don't know what you're going to, when you drag that net to the bottom, and when you bring that net up, you don't know what's going to be in that net. It could be old dog bones and old cans or dead fish. It can be some real live fish. It can be if you drag in the wrong place, you might bring up a human bone. Touching all that. So I was trying to crack a joke there, y'all just missed it. Okay, big old net, when the net comes up, you're going to get the good out of it, and then you're going to cast away the bad. So what is he all referring to here? Based on how you value the kingdom will determine what you get out of it. Look at the scripture. Don't look at me right now. Look at the scripture. I want y'all to see that. Read them. Based on how you value the scriptures will determine what you get out of it. Only you can make that determination. Only you can make that distinction. Nobody else can. Nobody else can. Nobody else can. Now, I want y'all to turn to Samuel, and I'm going to be reading out of the Amplified Version, 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel. And I want you to see how valuable King David sees God's Word. Now, I know some of y'all may know storylines about King David and about what he had did with Bathsheba, yada, 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 yada. Well, I'm going to tell you this. This section of story is after that incident. It's after the incident. Because leading up to Bathsheba, David, he valued God's word. And then sin got a hold to him, and he had to go through some challenges. And when he went through those challenges, he came out better. Why did he come out better? Because he found out the importance of how valuable God's word really, really is. Even in the midst of adversity, in the midst of he had the man set up to be killed because he had slept with the man's wife and got her pregnant. Now that's a real, I'm going to do that. I'm going to see God's value, put God's value of God on my life right now. And I'm going to go do some dumb stuff. No, it doesn't work that way. It does not work that way. It doesn't work that way. I have found out through 1 John 1:9, some of y'all may know it. It says, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. It says, if we can believe. It says, what is that word, 1 John? I'm stuttering. I'm sorry. 1 John. Y'all ain't got time now. This for me. But I want to make sure I'm saying it right. It said, if we confess our sins. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we confess our sins. Notice the Bible even says if. That even puts it back on you. Puts it back on you. When you do something stupid or do something dumb, or when you go out and commit sin, it's up to you to confess it. It ain't up to God. It's up to you to confess it. Lord, I lied. I sinned. I'm confessing this to you. I realize my mistake. I realize my fault. I realize I goofed up. Dumb. Stupid. I don't know. I was thinking outside myself. I'm confessing that to you, Father God. Will you forgive me? The Bible says God will be faithful and he'll be righteous. That's what the word just here means. Just to forgive you and cleanse you from all your sins. He'll cleanse you. All unrighteousness, and he'll forgive you. But it's up to you. It's up to you to do it. Now, backside of this, if you've put value of God's word on your life, Lord, you said blah, 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 whatever it may be in any area. Now, here's the kicker. You have to go read the scriptures to find out what God's word says about a situation. Some of us won't do that. You know, the Bible is a really, really, really good book if people take time to read it. It really is, and they give you so many different examples. But that goes back to you again. It's up to you how you have placed the value of God's word. It's up to you. It's not up to nobody else. See, why not? This is, pretend like God is right here. And this is what most of us do right now. I believe in God. I believe in God. I believe in God. And then as soon as you try to tell them what God's word says about a situation, well, I don't believe that. It ain't what you believe. See, it ain't about you. I don't believe that. The Bible been written so many times and so many people, and you know, it's been translated and people have screwed it all up. Yeah, but at the end of the day, it's still up to you to go find out what it says. Because if you don't do it, you basically say, God, I believe in you, but I don't believe in nothing you say. Yeah. Here God is saying, thou shalt not lie. Thou shalt not bear false witness. You come right on over here and lie. You have placed no value that God said, don't bear false witness. God, I heard what you said, but bump you. I'm going to go lie anyway. God says, Ivory, do not commit adultery. Love your wife. God, I heard what you said, but bump you. You see how fine she is. Ivory, don't do that. Okay, and okay, now you bumped God off so many times. Now God done this. He won't say nothing. Watch what King David did. 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel. Y'all there? Verse 1. If you go back and read, you had to go back and read 2 Samuel chapter 1. David, King David, had he. If you go read 1 Samuel, 1 Samuel was when David got put on the throne and he did a whole bunch of dumb stuff. Yada, 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 yada. He was king of the world, and he had sons, he had daughters, and they was growing up. And King David, he realized something, that God's word is very valuable, very, very valuable. Now watch what, now look what happened, 2 Samuel chapter 1. Now like I said, I'm reading out the Amplified version, it's going to read a little bit different. Look at verse 1. My Bible says, after this, what does King James Version Bible say?
Came to pass.
Came to pass. That means later. After this, David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I go up into any of the cities of Judah? And the Lord said to him, go up. David said, to which shall I go? And he said, to what? Hebron. Notice what's going on here. I was talking with somebody the other day, a sister in Christ, and at some point in time, your conversation with God is going to change. And it's going to change almost like God is just talking to you. I mean, the Bible says in the book of Numbers, when Moses, his brother and sister, that woman, here Moses is, he's a Hebrew brother, and he goes out and marries an African woman. and they get mad about it. You know, racism was going on there too. All this kind of prejudice stuff. And God says, wouldn't y'all even be somewhat scared of Moses? God asked questions, wouldn't you be kind of nervous me talking to Moses? Because I talk to Moses as I talk to him as a friend. I don't just talk to him in dark circles. Well, that's what's going on here with King David. At some point in time, the thou shalt nots and the thou shalt do's, you know, the to-dos and the to-don'ts are what the Bible says. But there's a whole lot of to-dos and there's a whole lot of to-don'ts. The to-don'ts is don't cuss nobody out. I mean, don't speak filthy communication. Don't commit adultery. Some of us, we get so caught up in the to-don'ts. The to-dos is what's going to keep you from doing the to-don'ts. That's just me right there. But look at the scripture. Look what just happened right here. Here King David is. He's saying, Lord, shall I go up there? And God said, yeah, go. See how simple that is? Basic conversation. Do y'all see a regular old conversation here? I know I do. Regular conversation. You are not going to be able to go into God's word and find in 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 15, I think you need to go marry Denise. Which Denise? There's a whole bunch of Denises out there. Well, she gonna come from Detroit, Michigan. She gonna be in Michigan, Amtramck, which you can never pronounce the name. You're gonna always screw it up every time you try to say it. And I need you to marry her at the age of 24 years old. You're not gonna find that in 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 10. It's not gonna be in there. So how do you get from thou shalt do's, thou shalt don'ts over here to Lord, should I marry this woman? Yeah, I think go ahead and get married to her. That's the one for you. And that's the one you're gonna be with. Marry her. How do you get from this to this? To this kind of conversation with God, to that kind of conversation with God? You start by seeking the first. Y'all just read it over there, and don't get caught up in that right there. You just read it right over there in the book of Matthew. What did he say? And Jesus said, and the kingdom of heaven is like unto the treasure hid in the field. It's hid. You bury yourself in the to-dos and the to-don'ts of what God's word says. And then you'll find Mary Denise. Not for me, not for me. It might be, your Denise may be an Angelica or something, or a Rachel, or a Jennifer. I don't know, it might be for you. Talking to brothers, marrying a woman. Y'all know what I'm talking about, they get all messed up. You get caught up in this, the first part of the scripture, and then you'll find the other stuff. You'll find it. Y'all are not listening. My time is about up on this subject right here. You bury yourself on the front end of this. When you start reading the to-dos, I used to come across some tough scriptures. Man, every time I read scripture, on the front end of my walk with God, I run into some tough scriptures, man. Don't do this. Don't do that. Don't do this. The lake of fire. Hell. You're in trouble. Reap what you sow. You're going to reap what you sow. And now in the world, talking about some karma. And I'm thinking in my head like, Lord, I want, created me a clean heart. How many times have y'all ever prayed that kind of prayer? I know I've prayed that prayer so many times. Created me a clean heart. Lord, I want your righteousness by faith. I want your righteousness. And Lord, help me. Romans 10, 19, I believe in my heart, confess in my mouth. Lord, you go through that process, and all of a sudden, one day you wake up, and then all of a sudden you see here, where'd it come from? You're like, the world? You go from here, Lord, should I go out and purchase this house? No, Ivy, don't purchase that house. Go buy the house anyway. And all of a sudden, I got to move out of the house now. God told you not to buy the house. You were believing for a regular conversation with God, and now all of a sudden, you get it, and you don't like what he's saying. Watch this. Verse 2. So David went up there with his two wives. I can't never pronounce these women's names. Anam, the Jezreelites, and Abigail, the widow of Nabal of Carmel. And David brought up his men who were with him, each one with his household, and they dwelt in the towns of Hebron. And the men of Judah came, and there they anointed King David over the house of Judah. They told David, the men of Jebusite Gilead buried Saul. Look what just happened. They anointed King David king over this whole new city now. Watch this. The men of Jabesh Gilead buried Saul there at that place. And David sent messengers to the men of Jabesh Gilead saying, may the Lord bless you because you show kindness and loyalty to Saul, your king, and buried him. Notice, king was their Saul, Saul was their king. They buried King Saul. Look what happened. If King David had placed value on God's word and what God's word had to say, King David would have not gone over to where? He wouldn't have gone over to Judah. He would not have got anointed. And those people would have missed out on a blessing from the king. I want y'all to see those connections. But it all started, go back and read King David, because he was seeking God and seeking God and seeking God. If you go read through the Psalms, you'll see what King David sought God faithfully every day. Lord, get these monkeys off my back. They trying to kill me. They set up trap for me. Lord, my enemies, please make my enemies your enemies. King David was praying prayers like that. They set traps before me. My eyes, if I had not seen your goodness, I would not have. If I hadn't believed for your goodness, I would not even see it. Lord, help me. Help me in my distress. King David would pray prayers like that all the time. He was seeking God's faith. He said, Lord, create in me a clean heart so that my enemies may not overtake me. Help me. He was seeking God. And now all of a sudden, Bathsheba, screw up, mess up. Oh, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord. Now all of a sudden, his baby stillborn, because out of that mess. And he mourned. It was like, this fool. He was mourning the whole time before the baby even came. Then when the baby came and he realized the baby died, shouldn't he be mourning? He said, no, the baby gone now. Baby in glory. Baby can't come back to me, but I can go to him. Oh, after this, anointed king, realized he made dumb mistakes. He started putting value back on God's word. And I can tell you now, that was me for a long time. Put value on God's word. Ain't left God, just ran away from him. Dumb stuff started happening in my life. Lord, what the world going on? You won't do what I told you to do. All right, it's time for me to put value back on God's word, and I ain't turned loose since. I have not turned loose since. I'm not turning loose. Why? I want to keep this conversation. Last thing I can remember, the very first time, the Spirit of God. Y'all may find it kind of, I don't tell too many people this because they think it's kind of spooky. But I was in prayer. One night I woke up about 3 o'clock in the morning. Actually, the Spirit of God woke me up. And it was like, I just heard, it's in here. I was sound asleep. Wake up. And I woke up, my eyeballs, you can get eyeballs wide awake. And I remember the old song. And he said, when you can't sleep at night, God is trying to tell you something. Y'all remember that song? I was the color purple, too. Cool, one of the old cool songs. I was laying in the bed. I remember looking over at Denise. She was sound asleep. And I sensed the Holy Spirit come into the room, and he sat at the edge of the bed. And I said, this is like weird. Lord, I thank you. Thank you. And all of a sudden, rose up on the inside of me. Ask God for some money. Ask God for this. Ask God for that. And I said, Lord, help me. I just need your help, Lord. I need some money. And the Holy Spirit said, I'm leaving. And he left. I said, and my brain said, you selfish thing, you had an interaction with the Spirit of God right now, and you went selfish. You couldn't even enjoy his company. I learned at that moment. At that moment, I learned. The money already mine. I just have to believe I received it. It's mine. Enjoy the presence of your Father. Some of us won't enjoy the presence of the scripture, thou shalt not. You won't enjoy that presence because you spend so much time letting everything else grab your attention. Last verse. Look what it says, verse 6. And now may the Lord show loving kindness and faithfulness to you. I also will do well by you because ye have done this. What did they do? All they did was bury their king. Instead of, talking about them, leaving them dead in the streets. and they went and honored them. Okay, he was our king. He dead. Let's bury him right now. That basic conversation with God, you sit down every day and you read the scriptures. You read. I don't understand it. Understanding right now is not, you don't need to understand it right now. Just read it. Trying to get you to start somewhere, man. Just start reading. I don't understand. No need to understand. Just read. And all of a sudden, the more you press in, you're going to run across the scripture one day and it's going to jump out at you. You're going to be like, oh, goodness gracious. Well, I understand that. And you're going to be like, oh, thank you, Lord. You revealed that to me. I thank you, Father. I thank you. I'm glad you revealed that to me. And now you found you a pearl. You found you one of those goodly things that came out of that net. That's the first pearl you're going to grab. And all of a sudden, you keep pressing in. And before you know it, you're going to find two pearls. Three. Five. And over time, it's going to grow. And you're going to really, really like these pearls that you grab a hold to. And then you're going to start incorporating them into your life. And you're going to be like, this is good stuff right here. Oh, man, I never knew I could have this. Now don't be trying to force this on somebody else. But you say, okay, I got this, Lord, I got this. And then when the Spirit of God do give you opportunity to help somebody else out, you say, hey man, God showed me this over here the other day. Why? I got the word. It's in me. You press it in. And for you, the TV shows, with the advent of DVR, you might be weeks on top of weeks behind your favorite TV show, and you could care less. Why? Because you enjoying your time with God. You enjoy your time with your wife, your husband, your children, your grandchildren, your mama, even when she make you take out the garbage 15 times. In your house, she make you take out the trash. Get mad at you because you use the wrong rag on the wrong sink. It's like, and you enjoy it. And all of a sudden, you go back and you find a goodly word. You're like, man, this is really, really good stuff. And if and you finally do want an opportunity to sit down and watch a television program, you're like, okay, which one am I going to choose from? Because I'm about 6 months behind, so I can care less. I mean, you just really don't even care anymore about those things. Why? Because your attention is on God. Man, that's good stuff right there. Okay. We'll be right back. Learn to follow Jesus Christ faithfully, holy. We'll be right back.